Welcome to Your Voice, a program for you to see how your voice is being represented in the New York State Senate with Senator Rob Ortt. I'm Julia Loekendy. Hi, Senator. How are you?
Hi, how are you?
And today we're also joined by Ken Brennan, firefighter from North Tonawanda, and that is where you live, right, Senator?
That's absolutely where I live. These are the guys who protect my family and a lot of other folks in North Tonawanda. They do a great job, and happy to have them here in Albany.
So, Ken, why don't you tell us what brings you to Albany today?
Well, each year, annually, the New York State Professional Firefighters sponsor and organize a legislative conference where professional firefighters from around the state come to Albany and meet with their local lawmakers to discuss and the current legislation that is coming up for votes and being presented. We speak in opposition of some legislation and others we support, but it gives us an opportunity to meet with our local lawmakers and share our needs and our concerns about current legislation.
So what kind of legislation are you talking with the senator about?
We've discussed there's a few bills this year that the state organization is very eager to support. One of them is a post-retirement cancer disability, which we discussed earlier today. Other legislation, involves municipal ambulances and their application process and renewal process. So it's varied, it's varied legislation from health and safety to retirement issues.
So, Senator, I can imagine that heart, lung disease, cancer, those types of things are prevalent in where you work. What are you looking at to help them with coverage on that?
Sure. Well, first of all, Julie, I want to thank not only Ken, but all the firefighters, both from North Tonawanda and across the state, who come up here today and speak to their lawmakers. And it's very important. I don't know of any lawmaker that doesn't want to support firemen,
right,
firefighters, people who protect their families. And by them coming up here, it helps us do that. It helps us, they can articulate these bills, we support, and here's why. These bills we oppose, and here's why. And, sometimes there might be a disagreement or a bill that, okay, I don't know if I can support this, but you try to find a number of bills that you can mutually support or you can go to bat for them. But the goal certainly is to make their job safer, make their job easier, protect, help their families. A lot of times there's bills that actually deal more with their families. A lot of times they're covered under, CBAs or collective bargaining agreements with the municipality or the state, but it's their families. Sometimes there's holes or there's gaps. Ken talked about the bill that they're looking at, which would, a lot of cancers specifically, these guys are rushing into buildings that are on fire. Obviously, a lot of times have smoke. I have asbestos that has now been, put into the air because of what's going on. So they're going into very difficult situations, and in some cases there's going to be health effects or health impacts, yeah, after they leave. And sometimes those health, especially with cancers, they don't come up in just 2 years. It takes 2 years in a day, or it takes 3 years or 4 years. So we want to be, I certainly want to be fair and make sure that we're doing everything we can to protect these guys who go out and protect us.
Ken, can you talk about some of the organizations that look after your interests?
Certainly. We're here this week with the New York State Professional Firefighters. It represents all of the professional firefighters in New York State in surplus of 18,000 members. The professional firefighters in the state of New York comprise only 22% of the total firefighting force, yet we protect about 76% of the population in the state of New York. And under the bigger umbrella is the International Association of Firefighters, the IAFF, which has an excess of 300,000 members in the United States and Canada as well. And it was founded in 1918, so it's been around for a good many years. It's headquartered in Washington. Our state, obviously, is headquartered here in Albany. And the International Association also has legislation that they do on a federal level, right in Washington. And New York State is obviously a part of that, and we're all members of both organizations. And as labor unions looking out for firefighters, they're constantly looking out for us. We pay dues to both organizations, and they look out, like the senator said, for our health, our safety, our security post-retirement, and things such as that. It's they're both wonderful organizations under terrific leadership.
So how long have you been a firefighter?
I've been a career firefighter for 24 years.
Started when he was 10, right?
Yeah, I wish. And it's been a very, very rewarding career.
And have you seen the role change over time?
Oh, the role in the fire service has changed dramatically just in the 24 years that I've done it. We've taken on a great deal more responsibility than we used to. I mean, many years ago, fire service, you know, was fire suppression. And then they branched out into the EMS. And more recently, we've branched out into specialty areas such as technical rescue, hazmat, fire investigation, which isn't new, but it's become a bigger part of what we do. And, you know, the diversification has helped us to, you know, better serve, you know, our communities, you know, that we serve on a daily basis.
Yeah, firefighters are often the first on the scene. The senator does a heroin task force, and I know that they're trying to get Narcan training across the board, across the state, but you said that you have been doing that for years.
Yeah, our department has critical care techs, which are advanced or even higher level than EMTs. And they have been administering Narcan, you know, intravenously for years.
So, you know, for people like me who have great respect for what you do, I know the risks that you take, but I can't truly understand what it is, what you see when you go in there. Can you describe it for us?
As far as, you know,
a fire.
Well, the fire scene, people ask you, what do you see in there? You don't see a lot. You know what I mean? I mean, reality is that the television shows, you know, don't do firefighting really any justice as far as really. I mean, it's like what you can see is really nothing. You so much of what you do is dependent upon your training, and it's all just instinctive and touch, feel. You know, but as far as visibly, there's not a lot to see, in many cases. Not in all cases, obviously, but in many of the cases.
So, what, Senator? What kind of legislation do you think could help firefighters?
Well, the cancer bill. There's bills out there that would assist spouses. With cost of living, spouses, especially of deceased firefighters who are now, you know, a lot of times on their own, they lost the breadwinner. And there's other bills. There's bills that go to that are non-monetary. We talked about that this morning. There's bills that don't have necessarily a monetary impact, but it might have to do with providing options or resources to flexibility, I should say, to local governments. Because again, much of what they do is sort of at the local level. These are firemen who work ultimately for the city of North Tonawanda or, you know, the city of New York City or Buffalo, wherever it might be, Medina, and so that's their employer, and a lot of it is just allowing them flexibility or options, allowing those communities options in dealing with their fire service. Because as Ken was just saying, not every fire, you know, everyone thinks of a fireman or a firefighter, they all do the same thing. But that's not always the case. You know, firefighters in New York City certainly have a very different working environment on a day-to-day basis than firemen in North Tonawanda. You know, Ken mentioned, you know, he started on the job and it was fire suppression. Now today we're talking about treating people who may have had a heroin overdose, you know, and going to the CCT area. So I think that's the important part, is to understand that you want to allow the flexibility at the local level. You want to allow the flexibility at their level to best serve their community. And the great thing about these guys is they live in the communities they serve in. You know, so they care as much about where they live as anyone else, and they want it to be safe. And I think you need to, you know, it's that bottom-up approach and not a top-down approach. So it's important, again, for us to hear from them hear their bills that they support, they oppose. Maybe we can make certain changes to a bill to make it a better bill, or just get that information from them so we know we're trying to advocate for them in the best possible way. Because as I said, I don't know any legislator here in state government that doesn't want to support or isn't supportive of people who go out there and protect us. So.
And it really does make a difference to reach out to your legislators.
Absolutely. Absolutely. You know, to me, these guys, they make the trip up the 90. I know what that drive is like. So first of all, I have a lot of respect for anyone that comes down here and makes that trip. And you know, we had a meeting this morning. They're meeting with other local legislators. And there's firefighters from across the state that are doing this today. And I just think, again, that's important to come up here if you can. You know, they come up, they're organized. They have the bills outlined. Everything is sort of researched, and they've done their homework, and now it's on us to do our homework and try to best advocate and represent them as possible.
So, Ken, do you have a breakdown, an annual breakdown of the call volume?
Basically, right now, in our department, you know, somewhere between 78 and 80% of what we do is EMS, and then the balance, the 20%, is fire suppression, motor vehicle accidents, and service type of calls. You know, where we go out and do a lift assist, or we do somebody has problems with a flooding issue during a storm, or that's what I mean when I talk about service type of calls. But that's basically 20% of what we do, and close to 80% of what we do is EMS. EMS has become an incredibly large part of our daily routine.
When did that transition?
Well, that's increased. You know, since I've been on the job, that's increased probably steadily each year. You know, when I came on the job, it might have been, you know, 60-40, you know, and now it's at the point where it's 80, close to 80-20. So it's you know, going up, you know, consistently each year.
So you were here yesterday, right? And today, are you going back today?
Yes, we are.
What was your agenda?
We came in and we met yesterday with the state organization, and we outlined the bills and that we were in support of and that we wanted to support and talk to our lawmakers about, and also the bills that we were opposed to, so that when we met with them today's the day on the Hill where all the firefighters come up and meet with their legislators. So the day before was kind of like a preparatory day where we go through the bills and discuss them, you know, one by one, and why we're supporting them and why we're opposing them, the ones we do.
So yesterday was International Firefighters Day. So I would like to say thank you for serving your community.
Yeah, certainly. It's what we enjoy doing.
Senator, you want to wrap it up?
Yeah, well, I want people to know, too, that, you know, when I say, hey, we want to advocate for firemen and firefighters, what we're talking about is really advocating for our constituents, because these guys go out and defend, and I should say just say guys, there's women, too, but these folks go out and defend and protect my constituents. So we're here to do the same thing. We're here to better protect our communities and better serve the people that we're entrusted with serving. So when I advocate for them, when a legislator advocates for the fire service, for firefighters, they're really advocating for their constituents as well. So it's not just about, you know, everything we're trying to do is to better protect our communities. You know, I want to thank Ken
for coming up here today.
Certainly.
For all that you've done.
24 years as a firefighter, it's pretty special, pretty incredible. And he's still got a full head of hair. So that's also special. But, you know, these guys, again, they put on a uniform every day. When they leave the house, they don't know if they're going to come back necessarily. You don't know what the day is going to bring. Yeah. And more, it's becoming a joint effort, as he was saying. You know, over the years, you know, every community resources, you know, there's less firemen today than there were, I'm sure, when you started.
Yes,
they're doing more. And in some cases, they're a more efficient department, but it's certainly more challenging on each member, and that goes for police and everyone else, volunteers, whatever it might be. So they're doing a great job, and to the extent that you guys come up here and let me know how I can better serve them and better serve the people of my district, I'm happy to do that.
Well, it was a pleasure talking to you both, and thank you for being here.
Thank you.
And thank you for watching Your Voice with Senator Rob Ortt. For additional information on what we discussed today, ortt.nysenate.gov.